Offshore oil drilling and oil spills are inextricably linked. It's drill, baby, spill. The environmental and economic tragedy now happening in the Gulf of Mexico, with thousands of barrels of oil gushing to the surface daily since the explosion at BP's Deepwater Explorer rig, stands to be the worst spill from an offshore oil rig. But in fact, spillage in offshore drilling operations is chronic. It was 40 years ago that, as an investigative reporter for the Long Island Press, I learned about this. In 1970, I broke the story about the oil industry seeking to drill in the offshore Atlantic. I got a tip from a fisherman. He said he had seen off the eastern tip of Long Island the same kind of vessel he observed searching for oil when he was a shrimper in the Gulf of Mexico. I spent the day phoning oil companies. PR people for each insisted their companies weren't involved in searching for oil in the Atlantic, but at day's end, as I was walking out of the office, there was a call from a PR guy at Gulf saying, yes, Gulf was involved in exploring for oil in the Atlantic as part of a consortium of 32 oil companies. These included the companies which all day issued denials. It was a first lesson in oil industry honesty, an oxymoron. In 1971, I visited the first drilling rig set up in the Atlantic off Nova Scotia. It was apparent on the rig that the offshore drilling process is fraught with danger. A rescue boat went round and round. Positioned on the rig were capsules designed to eject workers. The Shell Canada representative acknowledged that booms the oil industry claimed and still claims contain spills just don't work in over 5-foot seas. Not an especially unusual situation and a big problem in the Gulf now. I traveled on the story to Massachusetts, where the Department of Interior, an oil industry booster, was planning to give it leases to 800,000 acres on the George's Bank, one of the globe's foremost fishing grounds. I also went to the Florida Keys, in whose turquoise waters Interior would let oil companies drill. There was strong resistance up and down the Atlantic coast, which included lawsuits. In an environmental impact statement in response to a lawsuit challenging the leasing of Mid-Atlantic acres, Interior admitted recovery of the affected area from a large spill will be slow, probably requiring a minimum of 10 years. For the anticipated 20-year life of the field, it forecast 4 large spills of more than 1,000 barrels and 58 spills of 50 to 1,000 barrels. Much of the Atlantic coast, like the coast of Northern Gulf of Mexico, is composed of bays and miles of fragile wetlands where marine life breed and feed. It's a soft coast that would absorb oil like a sponge. Drilling of the Atlantic was stopped by congressional action, but this 2-decades-long prohibition would end if Congress goes along with President Obama's recent call for drilling to be done in the Mid and South Atlantic, the Eastern Gulf of Mexico, and off the north coast of Alaska. Last week, Obama refused to cancel the plan, but said he wanted to see new safeguards. That's a pipe dream. As the late Rhett Adair, who specialized in grappling with oil well blowouts, said, you can take all the precautions in the world and spills still happen. Besides the environmental devastation threatened, offshore drilling carries a huge price. The cost of offshore drilling is 10 times the cost of drilling for petroleum on land. That money would be far better spent on energy efficiency and vastly expanding obtaining the use of energy from solar and wind power and utilizing other clean, safe, renewable energy technologies available today. I'm Karl Grossman for Enviro Video.